Live from Music Row, studios of 1510 WLAC, it is the show for caregivers, about caregivers, hosted by a caregiver, bringing you 30 years of experience as a caregiver. I am Peter Roseberger, I am your host, and I am glad to have you with us. If you're joining us by iHeart across the country, thanks a lot for stopping by. We're glad you're here with us. If you want to be on the show, the number is 615-737-9522 or 800-688-WLAC, 800-688-WLAC. And it is a great day. We have a wonderful guest here in the studio. We're going to get to a lot of stuff here, a lot of information to cover. And we're so glad you're here. I'm never here alone, though. I always have with me himself, the Grand Master of Groove, the Fuhrer of Funk, the Ayatollah of Audio. He is the Earl of Engineering, and we love him and know him as the Count of Mighty Disco, John Butler, everyone.
I never get tired of the Merv Griffin theme, man.
Who does?
It's so good. I was actually thinking about 5 seconds before playing that I should do something Christmassy.
No.
It works. Merv Griffin wins. Absolutely.
The big band thing plays all year long.
It really does. And I love big band stuff. That's what I grew up on. Mom was a big fan of Gershwin and all that stuff. So
I love it as well. And I hope you have taken that love of big band into consideration today.
Oh, well, I mean.
In your offerings. and Merry Christmas, by the way.
Merry Christmas, Peter. It is a very special time of year for everyone, especially
It's the most
caregivers.
Wonderful time.
Well, you see, now I was going to play that, but I'm not going to now because you can't have spoilers because we're in the middle of spoiler season, aren't we?
I saw Star Wars this weekend.
Don't talk to me.
Well,
I quit.
Chuck Norris is in it. He's
okay,
the Force.
Cool. All right. And really, who else could be the Force? You know that duct tape is a lot like the Force?
Yes, it has a dark side, it has a light side, and it holds the universe together.
That is correct, sir.
There's not many Star Wars jokes that I don't get. I heard one about Alderaan today.
But don't bring up Alderaan. It's too soon, man.
It's too soon. If you don't even get what we're talking about, get in line. There's probably plenty that don't. Hey, listen, John, I have a very special guest in the studio today.
I saw her.
Rebecca Kelly. She is the state director for AARP. And we're going to be talking about this new survey. It's not a survey. It's a study, too, isn't it? It's a whole package.
Yes. It was a survey, but then results of the survey.
Well, we're going to talk about this today in a little bit here because there are some alarming numbers that have come through this thing, and it's affecting so many people here in Tennessee, and so many people are struggling with this issue. Of course, we've been saying this for some time here, so we're going to get into that. And we've got a lot of things to cover here, and we're going to also take your calls again, 615-737-9522, 615-737-9522, if you want to be on the show, if you got some questions asked. But AARP has been incredibly helpful to us. They're a sponsor of the show, but you guys have also sponsored a lot of the books that you've done with Wounded Warriors, with me, Caregivers of Wounded Warriors. And then the other thing is we've done a lot of projects together. It was AARP, John, that we did the You Might Be a Caregiver If with Jeff Foxworthy.
And
y'all were a little bit nervous when I first came up with that idea, weren't you?
Peter, you have put the delight in being a caregiver. You have put the you have added humor to being a caregiver. We really have enjoyed our relationship with you so much.
Well, that's
and you've helped us laugh about.
Of you.
No, I'm serious. You've helped us laugh about what otherwise is a pretty serious, somewhat lonely issue. And so you've been a gift to me and to AARP and to our folks.
Well, I think it surprised a lot of folks when we came up with that. With Jeff and I, and I'd asked Jeff if he wanted to do this with me, and he said, well, write out some jokes. I said, these aren't jokes. This is my life. And actually, I was filming a thing with Tara and Karen here from your office. Karen's no longer there. She's moved down to Florida, but she is they filmed me here when I first started doing the show, and they're the ones that gave me the idea with it because I was sitting there. We were filming something. I don't remember what we were doing for you guys. And during the breaks, I was kind of just riffing on some stuff. And I went, I was talking, imitated Jeff Foxworthy. if you have a professional carpet cleaner on retainer, you're probably a caregiver, you know. And they said, you ought to do that. And so I thought about that. And so I called up Jeff and asked him about it, and he agreed to do it. And so we did this thing, and I think it caught a lot of people by surprise that we could laugh at this sort of thing.
Well, I think what the truth is, the reason people enjoy Jeff Foxworthy so much is there's a whole lot of truth in a whole lot of what he says.
Well, and that's the thing about care. And he told me when I first started doing the show, he said, make them laugh, Peter. Mm-hmm. You more than most know how painful the life is of a caregiver, so make them laugh. And so we do. We have a good time, and we get into very serious topics and so forth. In fact, if you'll indulge me for just a moment, Count of Mighty Disco. And
I think
Rebecca,
I do that pretty much all the time.
You sell indulgences.
Yeah.
So, hey, a little reference to the Reformation here.
Exactly.
I just wanted to let you know I could.
Yeah. Well, I was talking about the 95 Theses the other day, so there you go.
you and Martin Luther, y'all are tight.
No, actually not. I grew up Catholic, so no, me and him don't get along.
No, you're not. It's too soon. It's
sorry, buddy. I'm so sorry.
But I want to do a new segment here today, John. I'm surprising you with this.
That's fine. This is
improv radio. Folks, don't try this at home. We're professionals, and you can get hurt. And it's all about safety with us, isn't it, John?
Absolutely.
I got a question. We're going to do a new segment called Caregiver Question, and I got a question this week. Now, this
Excellent.
Is a rather serious question, but I wanted to tell you all how I responded to this, and I think it may be helpful to those of you who are listening today that are wrestling with this same subject. But a lady called, and her father and mother – her mother's in pretty bad shape, and – her father is elderly. He's like in his 80s, been taking care of his mother, but it's too much for him now. And so they have hired a home service to come in, you know, home companion and so forth to help with stuff like we're going to talk about in your survey here in a little bit on what the desire for most people want to stay in their homes. Well, in order for them to stay in the home, they got to have some help. And they brought some help in, but it's really frustrating because they've never had somebody come into the home before. And this father was wanting to engage with this employee and to, can I get you something to eat? Can I do this and so forth for you? And he wasn't quite sure how to do that. He felt like she was a guest in the home.
Yes. He was trying to be the host.
Right. And, yeah. And
this
then,
is the South.
Pardon me?
This is the South.
Well, it is the South.
And, yeah, when somebody comes into your house, you offer them iced tea.
Well, yes, that's true. And so he's been real conflicted on this because he hadn't known what to do. And then he doesn't have clear instructions for her of what to do. So there's just a lot of adjustment going on. And I said, well, here's what I recommend. They asked me what to do because there was evidently a lot of tension. And I said, well, here's what I would suggest. I would, first of all, help him understand that she's an employee at this point. So he used to run pretty big size business. And I said, you wouldn't expect your employees to come to work and then go on break in 10 minutes after they got to work. Mm-hmm. And you know, here – punch in and then go fix yourself something to eat.
Right.
I said, don't think of it that way. You've got to learn to think this is this person's job to come in and help you with this. And then I would also recommend having a list of all the tasks that you want her to accomplish, whether it's preparing a meal or changing the sheets or doing the laundry or helping with the bath or whatever, anything that you want. I mean, they'll do light housekeeping and so forth. And then I said, also have a conversation with the company that you contracted with so that you have a regular engagement with these people so they can – and then give that list to them too so they can reinforce that. And you get out of the business of trying to engage with this person. They are there to perform tasks that you no longer need to do.
Mm-hmm. I think that's great advice, Peter. I really do.
Well, but this is a conflict that a lot of people are having.
Well, and I think a couple of things that you remind me of. One is if it's an employee, then that's absolutely important that you sort of distinguish and treat them, as you suggested, as an employee. If it's not an employee, we're still finding that caregivers feel guilt if they don't provide all of the service themselves. And so it's hard for them to sort of let go and say, yes, as a matter of fact, I would like to have some help, or it would be very helpful if somebody would come one day a week and provide transportation. And so part of what we encourage, which is very similar to what you said, is making that list of tasks. Think ahead of time of what you really would like to have help with. And it may take some thought because many caregivers, especially if it's in a relationship like a husband, wife, parent, child, they really believe it's their responsibility to do it all.
I have struggled with this myself. I knew I'd made a breakthrough because I have a lady that comes part-time to help me with Gracie on some things. And I just basically just say, look, you take care of Gracie. I'm self-sufficient. I'll take care of myself. And my office is in my home. And so I'm usually there all the time doing something, at least looking busy, John.
I didn't say anything.
Yes, but the look in your face. But I remember I reached a kind of a breakthrough when I started asking, would you please fix me a cup of coffee? Would you please fix me a sandwich? You know, these are things that Gracie would do for me if I asked her, but she physically can't on a lot of times. And so, and this lady said, yes, I'd be thrilled to do so. You know, I work for you. I'll be glad to do this.
I know how to work the K-cup.
And I thought, you know, that, but it took me a long time to get to that point. Mm-hmm. So I understand what this family is going through in ways that a lot of people may never understand, but I do understand that. And so it's always helpful if you will make a list of all the tasks that you want done. And then go ahead and share that list with the agency that you hired with. I know one of the sponsors of our show is Caregivers by Whole Care. Mm-hmm. Wonderful people.
All of our sponsors are wonderful.
They
people
are all
because
wonderful
we have
people
selected them.
We have. We have carefully vetted them. Too bad they didn't do the same.
I know. Oh, suckers.
Absolutely. Did.
But they have we Caregivers by Whole Care and they, you know, follow up with all the folks they send out there so that, you know, people can be comfortable with this so they don't have to feel like they get real nervous about it. And so that's what I would recommend if you're in the Middle Tennessee area, 615-298-9201. That's 615-298-9201. That's Caregivers by Whole Care, one of our sponsors. And they do this sort of thing. And this is what I'm trying to get people to understand, that it's a good thing to have help. And but you need to have good, clear boundaries on what you're wanting to do with this, you know, new assistant. And the other thing is what I found, Rebecca, that caregivers, when they get into the situation, when they get help, it's a little bit disconcerting because they're not sure what to do with free time.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. I just had about a paragraph and a half of things to say. And it's,
you know, but it's amazing how discombobulating it is to have free time when you're used to thriving on crisis.
Right. Well, and I was just thinking that, you know, part of the task list, this gives you a chance to do the things you enjoy doing. If you like preparing meals, then hang on to that task and let whoever is helping you, whether it's an employee or another family or friend or neighbor, do the things you don't like to do.
Like, I mean, the dishes after preparing the meal.
Exactly. And then in terms of what do you do with free time, more and more we're recognizing that the caregiver themselves are not taking care of themselves.
Well,
you are a good example of, and you have reminded us routinely of how important it is for the caregiver to take care of themselves. So in free time, exercise, you know, go to the doctor yourself. One of the things we're realizing is caregivers more and more don't keep their own primary care physician visits. They don't do their own annual exams and basics of just providing.
And that's a time
yourself.
Bomb. That
really
is a time bomb
really
because
is.
How do you expect – I think this is the problem, Rebecca, as I've thought about this. And by the way, if you're just now joining us, we're talking with Rebecca Kelly. She's the state director of AARP here in Tennessee, and they've come out with a new study of showing some alarming trends for caregivers. And if you want to be a part of the show, it's 615-737-9522. For those of you in McDuncan, that's 615-737-WLAC. And
Peter, I scolded you on air
about McDuncan. Bless their hearts. Bless their hearts. Hey, but this is I think that as we look at this thing with not wanting to take care of themselves, not wanting to do this stuff, not wanting to have, I mean, they don't know what to have for free time, and there's just a freak out mode. And one of the things I'm trying to do on my show is help caregivers rearrange the philosophy of this. We somehow think because they're disabled, they're elderly, they're chronically ill, that they're going to die before us. That's the underlying belief system that most caregivers have.
But even that, if it's not conscious.
Even if it's not conscious. We somehow think, well, they're sick. We got to do this and do what we can to make them comfortable, thinking somehow that we're going to outlive them. Mm-hmm. And maybe we do. But that is a really bad way to think.
And, you know, that'd be another great piece of research to do. We did not include that question, but I anecdotally, it seems like the number of caregivers that are dying first is increasing.
Well, the stress on caregivers is just insane.
Exactly.
If you have full-blown Alzheimer's, for example, in the family, the caregiver, it takes 5 to 10 years off of their life. I mean, there is a massive amount of strain. So
just look at Peter's hair.
I mean, yeah, I'm only 28. Heck, I'm Puerto Rican, y'all. I mean, look at me. Look what it did to me.
Well, and back to the survey, 90% of the respondents, 90% said emotional stress was the highest challenge they have providing care.
Well, and
you know, somebody should really do a radio show about this.
I think they should.
Yeah.
At least one that's heard a lot. Right, is that right, John?
I mean,
actually, our show, by the way, to our listeners, and we're going to go to a quick break here in just a second, but to our listeners, I want to thank you all for making this a very successful year. The show is growing. Lots and lots of audience members are coming in every day because they're thinking, wow, there's a show for caregivers. Who'd have thunk? Well, I thunk it.
And what station would that show be on?
1510 WLAC.
And if you wanted to call into that show, what number would it be?
It is 800-688-WLAC. 800-688-WLAC. And if you're listening on iHeart around the country, again, I'm glad you stopped by because this is extraordinary. Because of iHeart, we're able to be everywhere and on your phone, on your tablets, and so forth. So call a friend on the break. Let them know that there is a show for caregivers. Not only a show, we are the show. The nation's number one show for caregivers. I'm claiming the title, John. What do you think
about
that?
Capital T, the show.
The show. Hey, listen, this is Peter Roseberger. We'll be right back. One of my all-time favorite Christmas records, Chicago.
I knew that, and I know you said, hey, big band stuff and everything like that, but I knew that this Chicago album was...
There ain't many bands that are bigger than those boys.
Oh, I'm saying, they got a horn section. That counts as big band.
And I'm telling you, that is the coolest, funkiest arrangement of God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen. That is a very funky, cool arrangement.
A subjective opinion, but one that I think a lot of people would agree with.
By the way, I remembered my joke. You're looking for love in Alderaan places.
Oh,
for Star Wars, Alderaan.
Well, you can't find love on Alderaan. I'll tell you that right now.
You're looking for love in Alderaan places.
It's like looking for love on Vulcan. Remember,
if you get that joke, then you really are a Star Wars fan. And I did see Star Wars this week. It was really good.
I'm very pleased to hear that.
Hey, welcome back to the show for caregivers about caregivers, hosted by a caregiver. Who likes Star Wars. I am Peter Roseberger, and I'm glad to have you with us, bringing 30 years of experience to helping you stay strong, for you to stay healthy. Because why? Healthy caregivers make better caregivers.
Happy caregivers make better caregivers.
Well, yes, that's true. Happy caregivers make better caregivers. But and I see happy caregivers. Who painted those pictures? Who was the artist on PBS that did?
Bob Ross. Happy Little Caregivers.
I see Happy Caregivers.
Happy Little Caregivers. That's going to be our little secret. We're going to put a little caregiver over here.
Did you ever used to watch Bob Ross?
You guys are out of control completely.
Well, we are indeed, and thank you for noticing that. Hey, listen, if you want to be on the show, 615-737-9522, 615-737-9522, and we're here with Rebecca Kelly. She is the state director for AARP, one of our longtime sponsors, and we've done so many projects together to help caregivers both here in Tennessee, and we've done some national things from Tennessee that got picked up nationally through the whole AARP family.
Absolutely, and she's already been a great guest. I think one of the strengths of this show is not in how smart we are.
It's how smart our guests are.
It's how smart our guests are.
Oh, very kind. We've been a fan of Peter's for a long time. You really have brought so much to the world of caregiving. Your book, Hope for the Caregiver, is one of our favorites, and we actually use it every chance we get as gifts.
I heard the other day the lady came in, and she was just really torqued. She was under so much stress, and y'all gave her a lot of different things to help her, point her some respite care programs and so forth. And as she was leaving, someone put a copy of my book in their hands and said, "This is for you, for you." And she started tearing up, and I was deeply moved by that. And so thank you all.
Well,
and they've sponsored my book to go to Caregivers of Wounded Warriors and so many other different folks. We've done seminars together, and I'm just we're on a mission here to strengthen caregivers. Listen, we only got 1 minute for the bottom of the hour here, so I want to take this squeeze in a call here from John. John, are you with us?
Yes, I am, Peter. And don't forget how smart your callers are.
Well, yes, our callers.
Oh, absolutely. There. Look at he is on the ball.
Man, I tell you, you're on it like a pack of dogs on a three-legged cat. Well, what can I do for you today, John? Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you too. I just wanted to say, you know, what a great job you were doing there at the on the show and AARP. And I just wanted to say that, you know, when I became a caregiver a few years back, I found myself not exercising, not sleeping, not working, not doing much of anything except being a caregiver, which was a wonderful thing. But I found myself also hitting the wall and running out of energy and just about wearing myself right out. And the one thing that saved me was listening to your show, reading your books, and finally coming to the understanding that I had to take care of myself if I was going to be able to take care of someone else. So just wanted to say thank you so much for that advice, and I hope everybody is listening to that.
Well, John, thank you for that, and I appreciate it. And look, this is why we do the show, is just for that reason, what you just stated, because I know from personal experience what it's like to go into some dark, dark places as a caregiver. And I'm on a mission to reach as many of my fellow caregivers as possible to let them know that, you know what, there is a path towards you living a calmer, healthier, and even more joyful life, even while dealing with grim realities. The realities don't necessarily change. And the goal is not to feel better about this. The goal is to be better. And, John, you are better, and I'm just grateful for that, and I appreciate you calling in.
Thank you. God bless you all.
That kind of made my year, man.
It kind of made mine, too. That's a great Christmas present. Well, listen, we're going to talk some more here with Rebecca Kelly. She's got a new study out from AARP that they're talking about the alarming numbers. So don't miss this. This next segment here, we're going in deep on this. And I'm just grateful that you're with us. You heard what John said here. Look, this is a hard thing to do, to put yourself between a vulnerable loved one and disaster. But it is a lonely road, but you're not alone. That's why we're doing this show. We speak caregiver here. We speak it fluently. And I am glad you're with us. This is Peter Roseberger. This is the nation's number one show for caregivers. We'll be right back.
Outside is frightful, but the fire is so delightful. Since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, let it snow.
And I'm okay with that, John.
Show signs of stopping.
You know, how can you not feel good about listening to that kind of music?
When I was getting the music together for today's fantastic show, by the way, I let this one run the entire time. I just let it run.
And
had a great time.
It's hard to improve on perfection.
It really is, man. Well, you know, I have a little bit of a fight in my brain between Frank and Dean on whose voice I like better.
Well, I like Frank and Beans.
Frank and Beans.
Hey, okay. Welcome back to the show for caregivers about
caregivers.
I'm cutting
your mic later, man. That's all there is to it.
Hosted by a caregiver, I am Peter Roseberger, bringing you 30 years of experience to giving you 1 hour of respite every Sunday afternoon at 3. We're live on Music Row at 1510 WLAC. If you want to be on the show, the number is 615-737-9522. 615-737-WLAC.
We do really provide some respite. But I think that we need to bring into perspective that this respite is not just for our callers and listeners and guests. It's for you and me. You know,
this is energetic to me. This is part of my own journey of caregiver health, because we caregivers lose our identity when we're taking care of someone else. And it's very easy to do that. And it's not a slap against the person we're caring for. It's the intensity of what we deal with sucks our identity out of us, and we start speaking in third person singular, first person plural. We don't speak in first person singular very much. We don't say I. And we need to do that because it's very difficult to engage with somebody as an individual when they're lost as an individual.
And one thing that, because of doing this show, I have gotten in the habit of, when you come in, I ask you how you are doing.
And force the issue of me saying, well, let me unhook this rope from the ceiling fan and I'll tell you.
Yeah,
you know, that
you
kind of, you know, I'll be on, hold on while I put this toaster down and get out of the bathtub and I'll tell you. But this show has been, no, I'm okay.
Well,
this
no. And not just you. I mean that in the broader sense. When someone comes up, you know, in the course of my daily life, I meet people that are in the midst of this. And that is the question that I ask is, how are you doing?
It changes the way you interact with folks. And this has been my journey of finding my own voice, of coming on the show. And I listen to my own show. I go back when I do the podcast, I listen to it. And I read my own book because I need to hear from somebody who's got the kind of experience that I have. And so that's what I do. And I have very interesting guests on the show. I love it when callers come in. I love when guests come in the studio. And today I just wanted to, again, reintroduce you for those who are now just joining. It's Rebecca Kelly. She is the state director for AARP, one of our longtime sponsors. I've done a lot of projects with AARP. In fact, Gracie and I were just in the National Magazine last month. I was signing copies of that. I was speaking somewhere in New York, and people brought up the AARP magazine. I was signing copies of that.
Which is the widest distribution publication in the world.
Well,
Wait.
In the world.
It just eclipsed Mad Magazine, John. For those of you who try to keep up, John.
Right. Well, no, I didn't know that. That is an interesting thing to – that's a little piece of trivia that I need to tuck away.
Yeah. Well, you guys, the reason I have Rebecca on today, not only are they sponsored the show and great friends, but they have a new study out that was commissioned just for Tennessee, and Rebecca lobbied the AARP central office there in Washington, and they did this study of what's going on with caregivers in Tennessee. We want to see what's going on in Tennessee, and I think we can extrapolate the percentages are going to hold up across the country on this thing. I mean, the study is broad enough that you could extrapolate this to every state. But Rebecca, first off, what prompted this? I mean, y'all were just sitting around in a conference room one day and said, you know what, let's find out what's going on, or was there something else, or are you just feeling the urgency, or what?
Well, thanks, Peter, and it's so good to be on your show, and you are doing a world of good for literally thousands of people. We love and appreciate you, and especially the perspective you bring and the humor you bring to what's otherwise a pretty serious way of life. So more and more often, we were hearing people come through our doors, either physical door or virtual doors, and talk about the burden and the challenges and the stress of being a caregiver. And for the last few years, it has increased steadily. And then we are governed by volunteers from our national office, and we have an executive council in the state of all volunteers. And they decided that the number one issue for last year and this year and 2016 should be caregiving. And we didn't really know at the time what that meant. And we don't know a lot in terms of statistics about who this is. And so we said to our national office, we want to know who caregivers are in Tennessee and what do they look like, and what do the demographics look like, what are their challenges, what are their greatest needs. And so this new body of work has actually reinforced some of the thoughts that we already had, but the numbers and the percentages are greater than we ever thought of.
Hit me with some of these numbers.
So 90%. So let me go back. We did a statistically significant survey, a phone survey of 800 people from all across the state, from Memphis to Mountain City. And 90% of them said that the kind of activity they provide is shopping. 86% said they provide transportation. That's at the very highest of these folks. 60% of the people who responded, now these were likely voters 45 and over.
These are just volunteer caregivers. These are
random
family caregivers.
45. No, this is any voter 45 and over. We selected 800 of those voters.
They're not professional caregivers.
Exactly.
These are just the family members who are involved in these tasks.
And that's a good point, because often we're doing this and we don't even call ourselves a caregiver because we're just doing what makes sense. And so to narrow it a little bit, the official caregiving sort of label goes to those individuals who are providing some kind of hands-on care for someone who is ill or frail or mentally or physically disabled in some way.
I think I fit that bill, John.
I was being nice, man.
Well, it's like Jeff and I came up with, you know, if a hospital bed has never hampered your love life, you're probably a caregiver.
I have no response to that.
We did a disclaimer up front, didn't we? I think we did.
No use wasting that semi-private room.
Of the 45 and over voters, the respondents to this piece of research, 60% of them said they are right now providing care. 60%. Now, this is 45 and over. And the 55% of the rest said that they are planning to, you know, any day now. And so it is in our face. It is a way of life.
It is on our minds now, isn't it?
we are working and doing this. We are retired and doing this. And the more we can help, the better we're all going to be.
What surprised you about this report the most?
I think probably the challenges, and again, the high percentages. We knew that, for example, stress was probably the number one challenge that a caregiver faces. We were hearing that anecdotally. But this survey said 90% of them said emotional stress is the number one challenge they have.
Did they break it down on what were the leading causes of the stress? Because I have a theory on this. Did they break it down?
In some ways, we can either share that, or you can share your theory, or I'll share the results. It was a combination of balancing work and caregiving, or balancing caring for this individual and the rest of your family or whoever you might be responsible for, balancing that and work, and balancing that and financial issues, and then just balance. Period. Balancing caring for somebody else and caring for yourself. Not getting sleep, not getting exercise, and not keeping medical appointments.
This is proving my theory right. I've had this theory for some time that the issue for caregivers is not what some people may think of. There are tasks involved in being a caregiver that are really unpleasant, particularly when it comes to personal care and so forth. Those are really unpleasant issues. But I have for sometimes suspected that the biggest issue for caregivers that comes from the stress and dynamics involved in relationships. And it can be relationships with the person you love who may or may not be engaged. They may be impaired, or they may have some type of disease or something that cannot – dementia, whatever, is taken away from them. Or they are engaged cognitively when you're still having a relationship with them. You either got to have a relationship with the person that used to be there. Mm-hmm. But the other relationships are the family members that criticize you. I had somebody tell me that this morning in church, that they were struggling with this with one family member who was being critical of the way it was handled. And then you got those relationships. That's a lot of stress. Mm-hmm. And then you got the relationship stress with just you with yourself. Mm-hmm. You're in conflict with yourself. I have found as a caregiver that basically every day is a new day of conflicting emotions. Mm-hmm. And these are difficult, difficult things, and it just leads to a great sense of unsettledness. I gave today, I have, for example, I had to give Gracie an injection this morning. I have to give her one tonight. That's pretty normal. You know, I never thought I would be able to give injections or whatever, but it's not that big of a deal. I've changed dressings. I've fought with insurance companies and doctors and so forth. The issue of the emotional dynamics of what's going on in this situation, the chronicness of it, the late night conversations with the ceiling fan, mm-hmm. that's where the heart of a caregiver struggles, I believe, so much. Mm-hmm. And what your report is saying, yeah. When you got that many people with that level of emotional stress, nobody's saying changing an adult diaper, for example.
Right.
You know, that's not on the list. Yeah, it's unpleasant, but that's not what's causing the heartache.
Right. Well, and 84% of the responses said that a great challenge was the balance of work and family and the caregiving. And you were talking about relationships. As we approach the holidays, it is so stressful. And when families get together and they're not usually together necessarily as a family, then the stress is even higher. And, you know, you guys started this segment with, you know, how are you doing? And so often we say, how are you doing? And we keep moving. We don't stop and listen and pay attention to the answer to that question.
And you got to be slow when you ask that of a caregiver. They can tell you how their loved one is doing. I can rattle off Gracie's chart like that. I mean, it's no big deal. But to talk about myself on that and say how I feel about it, I'm going to stammer and stutter a little bit more.
Our volunteers over and over and over have said one of their greatest needs and what they are observing with caregivers is the need for somebody to just listen.
Mm.
Just listen. And so when you say, how are you doing? So often we may care and we may really want to know the answer to that question, but we're so distracted or so busy in our own lives that we keep moving. And so stopping and listening to the answer to that question. And you don't always have to have fixes or resources.
No, in fact, you don't. You really won't have fixes.
Right. We have a lot at AARP, but it's okay if you don't have a fix, because what they really need is for you to just listen.
Yeah. I mean, in my situation, there are always services that we could tap into, but you're not going to fix the situation with Gracie. I mean, I think a lot of people ask me that, and that, you know, she doesn't really change. I mean, she lives with an enormous amount of pain, an enormous amount of disability. She's not going to really change in that regards. And so I think people are surprised when they ask me, well, how do you want me to respond? You know, and so they ask about her and I don't think people quite understand that the chronicness of a caregiver. It doesn't really go away. It's not like a broken leg where it's going to get better or whatever. It is what it is. But we're gonna come back in just a minute and finish up this particular discussion here. We're with Rebecca Kelly from AARP here in Tennessee. If you want to find out more about what they offer here, AARP.org/TN. Now that TN stands for John, Tennessee. AARP.org/TN.
There are times that I really am upset that this isn't television because of the looks.
If looks could kill.
I'm telling you.
But AARP.org/TN, and we're here with Rebecca Kelly. She's the state director for AARP, and I'm glad you're with us here. This is the nation's number one show for caregivers. I am Peter Roseberger. Glad you're along. Don't go away. Listen to these sponsors because we handpicked them for you. These are resources that you can tap into right now. Don't wait. Go ahead and listen in and see what you can do today to make your life a little bit easier. That's what this show is about. Hey, this is Peter Roseberger. We'll be right back. Hey, welcome to the show for caregivers, about caregivers, hosted by a caregiver and also produced by himself, the Count of Monte Disco. Merry Christmas to you, John.
Merry Christmas to you, Peter. I know that you love Fog Hat.
I do indeed.
Because you're a fine American human being.
If I do say so, my fine American human being
self. There you
go.
All right. Well, you also use Fog Hat a lot on the show.
Well, I do because FOG stands for fear, obligation, and guilt, which are the three things that caregivers deal with. Every caregiver deals with fear, obligation, and guilt, which leads to heartache, anger, and turmoil.
That's a mnemonic device for y'all in McDuncan.
It is indeed a mnemonic. And how do you spell that? K-N-O-O-M?
No, it's M-N, like Johnny Mnemonic. You remember that?
I know how to spell it.
Listen,
we're glad to have you back with us. 615-737-WLAC. 615-737-WLAC if you want to be on the show. And I just got a text here from Ethel.
Ethel
said she loves the show, and she said, we're as good as Johnny Carson and Ed McMahon.
Hey.
Ethel.
Whoa. Ethel, we just want to take a moment to say, bless your heart. I said, bless your heart.
You need to get a turban.
Yeah. Oh, I could be the Mighty Karnak.
Yeah, you
the
totally
Rosenreck.
Yeah, there's no there. And you know, Carson was just a little before my time. I'm not going to. Not going to say anything or anything.
He
like
wasn't
that.
Before,
but he is. He was just the best. He was the absolute top of his game always.
Always. Well. Listen. Speaking of top of the game, let me ask you something real quick. Have you got all your Christmas shopping done? I've got one more present that you can do, and you can help me out with. Standing with Hope, you can give the gift that keeps on walking and sponsor a limb. This is the organization Gracie and I started many years ago when she gave up both of her legs and she wanted to be able to provide quality prosthetic limbs to her fellow amputees and use that as an opportunity to share the gospel. That's very simply what we do at Standing with Hope. And we've been doing this for over a decade now where we have trained and equipped local workers in West Africa to build limbs and maintain them for their own people. And you can sponsor a limb. It's really easy to do. $30 a month for a year sponsors one leg, or you can do a one-time sponsorship of $350, and you can help us put a leg on someone and give them an extraordinary gift. So this year, instead of just hanging empty stockings, put a leg in it.
Oh, Peter, don't be a heel.
Oh, step up.
And I'm just trying to toe the line here.
We got to stop. Make it stop.
I need to apologize to your listeners.
But, you know, it is an extraordinary thing. And I think I told you, John, about the little girl, Annette. It just broke my heart.
And mine too, on the air.
1 year old. And I just got the picture of her, 1 year old, and they put a leg on her, but she had had an infection in her foot. And the doctors there in Ghana went on strike, and they couldn't treat her. And so she ended up losing the leg. But our team that we work with over there, our supplies that we send over there, our training helped this little girl now be able to walk. And it's a hard thing in life, even in America, as somebody with disability with a prosthetic limb, it's hard enough. But in a developing country, when you're a girl, no, that's just not cool. And you can help us address that problem today. So go to standingwithhope.com. Go out there today, standingwithhope.com. And look for a way that you can be a part of this. You know, if, whatever you want to do, whatever the Lord lays on your heart, but we're going to tell them about Jesus. We're going to put a leg on them, and you can help us do it at standingwithhope.com. Listen, we're going to finish up here real quick with Rebecca. Rebecca Kelly is from AARP, Tennessee. She's the state director for the entire state, all the way from Memphis to Mountain City. And they've just come out with a new study on the realities of caregivers in Tennessee. I mean, the numbers are really alarming. And there are a couple of resources that we particularly wanted to point you to today in the little bit of time we have left. Elder care. Now, this is on everybody's mind because we got this huge baby boomer population. Rebecca, this is nationwide because we have listeners on iHeart across the country here. So if somebody is dealing with this issue and they are really struggling and feel like they're underwater, give us the number they can call.
That is 1-800-677-1116. And that's the toll-free number for the Elder Care Locator number. And that's a generic resource sponsored by the Administration on Aging. And they try their best to have every available service provider in a particular zip code. So, again, that toll-free number is 1-800-677-1116.
Now, all this stuff is at your website. They can.
That's right.
So that's right. aarp.org/TN for Tennessee. AARP.org is the main site, of course, and then /TN. And you'll find these things. But that is a valuable reason, all the way down to the zip code. So if you don't know who to call in your zip code, not in your state, in your zip code, AARP's done the homework for you on that. And this is why these guys are involved with this show and why I'm so grateful to have them, because they bring the vast resources they have to help you with this. The purpose of this show is to do two things. One of them is we want to help you walk back from the cliff a little bit of this craziness that consumes caregivers. We want to just slow walk you back and let you know you're going to be okay. See, it's not insurance that we find that's the biggest problem for folks. It's assurance. And we want to just put an arm around you and say, look, it's going to be all right. We're going to walk you through this thing. And then put your hand in the hand of somebody who can help you. Put your hand in the hand of somebody with resources and products and service that can help you. And one of those is AARP. And they've got, gosh, you guys have done so much work out there and all that. What's another thing that you wanted to hit real quick in the last little bit of time?
So much of what we know is what you all have told us, just research and stories and research and stories. And so we've put together a caregiver resource guide, and it is absolutely wonderful. It may not answer every single question you have, but it is a tremendous place to start.
And it's free.
It is free.
You don't even have to be an
AARP member. No,
see?
Just go to our website, www.aarp.org/caregiver.
I mean, how hard is that? And we'll have this out on the site, and I'll put this in the blog. But you don't have to be old. You don't have to be retired. You don't have to be anything. You just have to be in need. If you got a need, guess what? They've got some stuff for you. Rebecca, we got to do another show, don't we?
I'm ready. Thank you so much.
This has been a real treat here. I know she said she'd come back. I don't get that often. I don't get it either.
You know, I'm telling you.
Yeah, listen, speaking of come back, you all come back. First off, have a Merry Christmas, and we'll see you next week. This is the nation's number one show for caregivers. We're grateful that you're here. And I am Peter Roseberger. Go to standingwithhope.com for more. We'll see you next time.